Hi, well, I'm glad everybody's here right now. We, Neubecker, has graciously agreed to be our keynote speaker. Lee lives in River Forest and he's been in security for a long time. And he's going to talk about the next cyber war. The next cyber war begins. I guess that's... Lee has talked for this conference in the past and has always been a very, very evocative and entertaining presenter. So Lee, thank you.
Thank you for having me. Also, I founded a computer forensics firm back in 2000 called Forensicon, and I sold that company last year. My interest has shifted more into the cybersecurity realm and away from attorneys. But I'm enjoying my my time being able to research things and not having a full-time job at the moment. So it's nice to be able to reconnect with my kids and get some chores done around the house and whatnot. But in my spare time, over the last year, I've been analyzing some of the malware that's been coming out, including the remote control systems hacking team code. I had a video playing if you were here. It kind of is a demo that shows how governments can pay this Italian company to hack into computers anywhere around the world. And I'll be talking much about how that happens and what the current state of computing is and what you can do and what you can't do about it. And try to conclude with some time for Q&A and discussion about public policy and where we should be going to, you know, to the future. So before starting the forensic firm, I worked at Lycos.com, the search engine, and there I managed chat message boards, games, kind of prehistoric Facebook. And it was a really fun job because I took that after going to grad school, largely because my father told me when I was 11 that I was wasting my money running a BBS service using a modem line to run a Wildcat BBS. So my experience from way back kind of built up and pulled me all the way through to where I am today. And I'm going to be sharing, I'll share the presentation on my new blog that just launched, LeeNeubecker.com. And so if you want to copy the presentation, you can go there. So today I'll be talking a little bit about some events in the news. I'll play a few more clips for you. Then we'll talk about what happened with computers since roughly the 2005 to present and how those changes have created a new attack surface that many people don't know about that is currently being exploited in the wild. We'll talk a little bit more about some of what I call super nation state malware, which now is not just in the hands of nation states, but potentially in the hands of kids at home, other hackers that may want to cause harm. I'll discuss some of the attack points and some of the vulnerability layers that many of you probably didn't know about. I know I didn't know about some of them a couple years ago before doing analysis and realizing that different connections were happening other than those you would expect off Wi-Fi or Ethernet. And then I'll talk a little bit about how you can safeguard yourself, and hopefully I'll leave all of you not feeling too paranoid to go home. Let's see. So some of the items in the news, there have been Snowden disclosures, the OPM Data Breach, hacking team code posted, hacks of the campaign last year, the US CERT issues advisories to business and industry, and they issued an advisory last October, which was really the first of its kind of acknowledging this whole new form of malware that's running rampant. I'll talk about that some. And then the recent CIA Vault 7 leaks of CIA cyber weapons, which I believe to be a real threat.
America is a fundamentally good country. We have good people with good values who want to do the right thing. But the structures of power that exist are working to their own ends to extend their capability at the expense of the freedom of all publics.
Can you talk about what you think some of the most important primary documents are and what they reveal?
The primary disclosures are the fact that the NSA doesn't limit itself to foreign intelligence. It collects all communications that transit the United States. There are literally no ingress or egress points anywhere in the continental United States where a communication can enter or exit without being monitored and collected and analyzed. They're using an authority that was intended to be used to seek warrants against individuals, and they're applying it to the whole of society by basically subverting a corporate partnership through major telecommunications providers, and they're getting everyone's calls, everyone's call records, and everyone's internet traffic as well. The NSA lied about the existence of this tool to Congress and to specific congressmen in response to previous inquiries about their surveillance activities. Companies like Google, Facebook, Apple, Microsoft, they all get together with the NSA and provide the NSA direct access to the back ends of all of the systems you use to communicate, to store data, to put things in the cloud, and even just to send birthday wishes and keep a record of your life. And they give NSA direct access that they don't need to oversee, so they can't be held liable for it. I think that's a dangerous capability for anybody to have, but particularly an organization that's demonstrated time and time again that they'll work to shield themselves from oversight.
I'm sure there's many opinions on Snowden out there, some that feel strongly that he should be punished severely, some that look at him as a hero. My point today in bringing this up more, though, is to draw on the fact that if we have our data being copied and retained and that organization isn't able to protect its own infrastructure, then it's putting us all at risk. And there's some actions I think we need to take, regardless if we're going to continue monitoring or not, to make sure that our country is safe.
A National Security Agency contractor in the U.S. has been arrested and charged with taking top-secret information. Harold Thomas Martin III was detained last August after his home in Maryland car and garage were searched.
Among the information that the FBI believes he stole were documents detailing a sophisticated hacking tool that the NSA developed to break into foreign computer systems. A couple months ago, the computer code for the tool showed up on the internet. Someone calling themselves the Shadow Brokers was offering it for sale online.
Looking at the incidents in the last few years, which do you think compromised U.S. intelligence assets more? Bradley Manning, now Chelsea Manning's leak of information, Edward Snowden's leak of information, or this hack?
This may be in the number one spot because you're talking about individuals going back to 1985, people who had filled out applications, may not even been hired, but people who were hired. And so when you have literally millions of people who have been in our system, you have intelligence agencies that might be able to go back and map something. So I worry about those families, and then they have to live with this. People who have done this type of work for the United States, they're going to have to live with this for the rest of their life, looking over their shoulder, wondering, what do these other people know about me?
And when you talk about these other people, are we 100% sure that it's the Chinese?
I can't talk about that at this point. I think they're still trying to decipher and figure that out, but you just don't know when it's an electronic format whose hands it may or may not have gotten into. So we really don't know. And one of the deep concerning problems is they still haven't fixed it. We're still pouring information into the system that is not safe and secure. This is a 1960s system, COBOL operating system without dual authentication, without encryption. And that's still the system they're using. They don't have one that has fixed the problem here today. So moving forward, we're still in the same mess.
That's unbelievable. Congressman Jason Chaffetz, thank you so much for your time.
Thanks, sir.
So we can see that there's incident after incident of people working as contractors or working with NSA that ultimately result in further data breaches. So this is a real problem, because even if you really want to have that capability with our government, if our government can't keep those tools safe, then it puts everyone at risk.
An Italian software company that helps governments hack into computers and spy on people has itself been hacked. The company is called Hacking Team, and hackers took over the company's Twitter account on Sunday and leaked out internal documents, emails, employee passwords, and source code. What you're looking at now is a commercial for this hacking team company. It advertises its software as an untraceable way for governments to hack into any computer to spy on someone. 400 gigabytes of documents from this company were dumped online. But as of this report, the files cannot be independently verified as being real.
So you can see this company, I was playing their demo earlier, some of you may have seen, but they have, they claim to be able to hack all levels of operating systems, smartphones, tablets, and whatnot. And their code was posted shortly after the government data breach took place. And I spent some time analyzing the code and reading the user manuals and whatnot. And it was pretty spectacular software because it allows to attach to your international mobile phone subscriber number. It can lock onto your phone and follow you and persist and jump to any computer you're around. And this actually has been a great tool for us to be able to catch terrorists, send drones and whatnot to take people out. But these tools have been, the source code for these tools have been in the public domain now for almost 2 years. And there hasn't really been a lot of discussion about it. And only recently, the updates that came out in March have started to patch a lot of the vulnerabilities that allows these tools to work. But I'll be talking about more about that in a moment. Let's see. So the government issued an advisory back in October, and it was to Industrial Control System Emergency Response Team, all the people that run the the water, the utilities and whatnot. And I had deduced a lot of this before this was out there without the benefit of having government data, but analyzing it and seeing how it worked. And what I discovered was that the malware would exist on board the hardware components and not just on the hard drive. You could pull a hard drive out of a computer that was infected and replace it with a newer drive, rebuild it, and the infection and backdoor would come back. And there was a researcher a while back that was in the news that talked about bad BIOS many years back, and I spent some time talking with him. And we had deduced that the computer, before it loads operating system, the components on board, like Bluetooth, your Wi-Fi, your infrared, and get this, even your sound card has something known as open sound control that can allow for near bandwidth communication between devices. Now, this comes out of a MIDI technology made for music, but it allows for information sharing at a low bandwidth between devices. And then, if you, the mouse, there's patents filed by a company called Microtech for mice. And beginning sometime in the late 2000s, they filed a patent to put a transmitter in that could relay instructions remotely. So, we'll talk a little bit more about how to keep yourself safe, but I don't want to skip ahead. But one of the things that the advisory talked about is that the USB firmware and USB devices being at risk. If you work in government now in the intelligence capacity, they don't allow any USB devices. And the reason for that is the USB devices can, when you plug in a USB device, it will automatically recognize and set up for you. Does anyone remember the old days where you had to get a diskette to configure your network card or modem or anything? Well, then plug and play came around. Well, plug and play basically said, we're going to put a chip inside of every peripheral so that we can store the driver software in there so we don't have to have a separate disk. But that chip inside that can store, it's a flash chip, flash storage that can, known as SPI, serial peripheral interface, it can store drivers. Well, they figured out how to put malware into the chips. So you've heard about things such as bad USB and other devices. So you could have a totally brand new computer, and you could be trying to follow a scientific process like I followed with using an external USB CD, and be isolated. And when you connect that USB CD to the computer, as it recognizes a driver, it does an exploit and takes over the computer, and your computer's owned. So I bought a lot of computers over the last year, and I'm a big fan now of the $199 Dell that if I need to replace it, I'm not out of a lot of money. But it's a real risk, and it's one that many people don't know. And so if you're unfortunate enough to be targeted initially by a nation state, or now someone who got those tools that's trying to attack you, it can really make you feel like you're banging your head against the wall trying to figure out how this thing is happening. And you can be reinfecting yourself without even knowing it as you hook up to a monitor where it passes the driver from the monitor on board, or you reuse a mouse, keyboard, or CD-ROM, or anything else that might be problematic. And that fundamentally happens because the peripheral makers aren't requiring signed drivers on their devices. So there's some things that the manufacturers need to do that could help protect it. And I think there's one USB company out there that makes something called a kangaroo drive, and it's encrypted, and the firmware on the stick is signed, and it's got protection to protect it from exploits such as StatX. They can take it out. So the advisory goes on to talk about the BIOS of potential vulnerabilities at the BIOS level and how code can be injected into the BIOS that basically takes over the computer and can persist and make it near impossible to get rid of. The advisory goes on to say only fully restoring the BIOS of the motherboard would take it out. So to remediate this stuff, you really have to have a chip flasher and know how to do pretty sophisticated stuff, which most IT departments don't know how to flash their own chips. And much of this wasn't even known previously. How many people heard about Vault 7? Raise your hands. So, testing. Vault 7 was WikiLeaks had posted a bunch of sensitive documents that were provided to it. Mostly they posted user manuals, and they said they'd make code available to security researchers to help patch stuff. Well, since the posting, I can say that I've seen that a lot of there have been a lot of fixes to try to prevent against these attacks, but there's still, if the stuff's floating around there, it's likely in many other places, and it's something people need to be concerned about. I believe that much of the data to be authentic based on my review and it correlating things I had researched before it was leaked. One of the leaked documents from March 23rd posted to WikiLeaks talks about dark matter, and it gets into this whole concept of firmware on board and talks about how Apple devices can have the EFI, UEFI regions of the boot process infected with malware that can take over the device. And I'll talk about that more. This isn't really specific to any one platform though, and I'll explain why that is as I get onto this further. So to understand this, you really have to know what happened with computers and how they converged. Today most computers run off a low-level Linux OS to boot up and then to load whatever you're going to run, whether it's Mac, PC, or Linux. So there's actually a pre-layer to it, and the grub bootloader is commonly used to load that up, and we'll talk about that a little bit more. But in the old days, there was BIOS, and you had a chip on board, and it would store certain information, and parts of it, there was ability to write and save options, but it had some limitations in terms of how much memory it could address, how many partitions it could support, and the size of those. Most BIOSes had no signature checks on it that would enable some level of validation that whatever BIOS update was authentic was there. That's changing today, but it remains a historical problem. So one of the things that Intel did is in 2005, they donated their EFI project to the UEFI Forum. And this was a consortium of hardware makers, manufacturers, peripheral makers, and operating system providers to all bring computers to common platforms so the issue of the drivers loading could be recognized before it even loads operating systems. So before you even boot your Windows CD or in your hard drive, there's a whole layer, another layer operating, and there's a lot of exploits available there that are currently taking over everything from Cisco routers to people's TVs and their homes and smartphones. This was a very effective way, though, for the government to engage in counterterrorism operations because they could write code at a layer that was up there above the kernel that could control and move across any device and exploit the target. But with those new vulnerabilities, you know, the exploits came in, and it was only a matter of time until, you know, lots of bad people know about them too. So UEFI stands for Unified Extensible Firmware Interface, and instead of the boot code being stored in the BIOS, it sits in the EFI directory, but it also can, parts of it can also be in NVRAM, like on a Macintosh, it has NVRAM, it has SPI chips for the peripherals and so on, but there's a lot of places things can be stored, and the malware makers have mastered how to write it to many different places. I remember doing testing, though, and clearing the NVRAM out and getting different boot sequences that would happen. Even if I swapped my RAM around and pulled my RAM out, the behavior of the computer would alter when I was doing testing. Eventually, one of my Mac Minis I was testing with just got bricked, and the Apple Store didn't know why, and they weren't really all that helpful. So I called a security researcher that had disclosed these vulnerabilities a long time back, named Corey Kallenberger. He had been hired by Apple to help secure this stuff subsequently. And I got him on the phone and I said, what do I gotta do to fix this Mac? He's like, you gotta replace the motherboard. So I had hoped there'd be a CD or a disk that could repair it, but the problem is once the BIOS, once a bad BIOS gets in there, it can prevent any good updates from coming in as well. So really securing computers from the BIOS onto all the downstream boot components is critical. There's many places that can store data pre-operating system boot. One of the advantages of UEFI migration, though, is it allowed different partition types. The GPT partition can support 120 logical partitions on Microsoft and virtually unlimited on others. The size limitation of 2.2 terabytes was shattered, and now it is technically possible for 9.4 zettabytes to be addressed, which is 1024 times 1024 onward of terabytes. It's just massive volumes of data. It does shorten the boot time on the computer. If you have secure boot turned on, it can help provide some protection, but those keys could be vulnerable to different types of memory, buffer overflow attacks, everything from swapping out a graphic that loads or a font when a computer's first coming on, to trick and inject a payload into memory to compromise a computer. The common thing about UEFI, though, is that it allowed for the CPUs, both Intel and AMD, and regardless of the operating systems, all the drivers became kind of a common framework that didn't need an operating system. So when you're turning on a computer, it's loading up all your peripherals and everything long before, but with those drivers that get loaded comes the vulnerability and the exploit place where these attacks are happening. But here's a diagram from Intel that describes kind of the process of what happens on the computer. So initially you have some security functions, checking of the keys and whatnot, unboot before it loads some of the pre-EFI initialization factors. And then the driver execution environment is where a lot of attacks take place. There's something called SMM, which is system management mode. And this is what I call the secret government backdoor. They put a modem on Intel processor chips that allows for the computer to call home and you to find it if someone steals it, connects to 3G network. Even if you don't have a network card or modem or anything else in, that computer has ability to dial out and be connected and be tracked. And that's what a lot of people don't know, but you can see that on Intel's websites and their patents, and that's been, you know, happening since the mid-2000s. With the system management mode, the disclosures that happen, the system management mode can allow you to re-image a drive, boot up a computer while someone's sleeping, schedule call-outs, override DNS, do a lot of other things. And there's documentation on that. You know, they try to market it as a legitimate resource management for companies, but it's built into all the chips. And you know, how many people knew that there was a modem on board your Intel chip that could call a network without you configuring it? Not many people knew that. A few guys here. Okay. So the bootloader follows in the process, and that it used to be NTLDR. It would say if you didn't have a hard drive in, it would say NTLDR not found, and it wouldn't boot. Well, the bootloader now resides in areas on board the chip, and it will use grub, so it can have instructions to call out to look for network devices on a network to load things. So even if you don't have a hard drive in, it can have instructions to do to look around the neighborhood to see if it can get its malware code to propagate. So GNU is grub is short for Grand Unified Bootloader, and it's GNU is not Unix. GNU, that's what it was named, but it's an open source free project that started, and that is kind of the fundamental start to the boot process. That if you really want to get into a computer and know what's going on, learning grub takes you up a level above the operating system. And if you're trying to root a cell phone or a tablet, typically you're using some type of grub bootloader to try to put a new image in. So there's a great presentation on YouTube that I saw about a year and a half ago. This is Corey Kallenberg. He's a guy who got hired off to Apple. But he talked about what he called extreme privilege escalation in UEFI systems and how the SPI flash memory could be used as a vector to basically totally take over the computer. So here's some more Intel documentation on system management mode. It talks about it taking control of loading drivers, being able to store things, boot agents, runtime agents, and so on. And SPI, again, serial peripheral interface, that was attack vector Corey was talking about. And the code basically gets loaded into RAM off the chips and runs above the kernel, so you can't necessarily detect what's going on because it's almost like your computer becomes a virtual machine controlled by a parent that you can't see. And back to the diagram there, it's really, you can see in the sequence, the third tranche is where SMM resides, and then the boot device selection with the bootloader, and then it loads operating system and the transient system load time. But if you get into the SMM, you can override and have instructions for it to load into RAM and modify the operating system, modify the certificates, the trust, and really change the behavior of the computer. This is a patent I found. It talks a little bit about the SMM recovery function, how SSM works, and it discusses the call out for recovering your computer, the heartbeat. This is a secret signal that gets sent out from the computer that allows for activation and control. So I talked a little bit about the history of computing platform conversions. There's been, you know, a lot of positives, not having to carry those driver disks around are good, but the lack of those SPI chips on board the USB devices being properly encrypted and protected with signatures and whatnot has allowed for a whole new exploit vector. And you know, this has been out of the bag now for more than 2 years, but it doesn't seem that much is happening yet to really patch it, because on one hand, you know, I think it's many of us would agree it's great for a country to be able to pursue the bad guys, stop terrorist attacks before they happen. But at the same time, if those tools and vulnerabilities are becoming widespread, known by many people, then it creates a risk for our businesses, for ourselves, and our economy. Some of the things that that I've observed too is, you know, any of the functions, the keys, you know, the key that you might enter to enter BIOS or whatever. If you're taking control of the computer before the OS loads, there are fake BIOSes where you think you have a BIOS, a fake clock time, many other things. So you really get to a point where you can't fully trust and know that what you're doing, that you're really working with what you think you are. And if you find yourself scratching your head, thinking things aren't working right and things don't make sense, there's probably a reason for that. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about why this is a threat, why the malware is a threat, why we should all be concerned, where it resides, how it infects, what it does, some means of detection, how to remediate, and my thoughts on prevention. So the timeline of events I have up here, you know, in January 2015, Corey Kallenberg disclosed publicly these vulnerabilities, which means once that happens, then all the other nation states lock in and research it and figure out how to exploit those vectors if they haven't already. So roughly, you know, 6 months later, OPM got hacked, which compromised all of our intelligence staff, put people at risk of harm. And then the next month, the hacking team, all their source code, their manuals, everything that, all their knowledge of how to exploit all these different operating system computing platforms and whatnot, got put out on the web for any and all to see, people to repurpose and take their tools, reformulate them, use them to attack. So since July 15, we've had such an accelerated rate of data breaches and attacks. I mean, I've gotten probably at least four letters, healthcare providers, whatnot, telling me my data was breached. I'm sure all of you have had similar things happening. And you know, many people are growing complacent, like, well, this is just how it is, and there's not much we can do about it. But there are things that can be done, and we'll talk about those. It wasn't until October 2016, though, that they really issued that October malware advisory, where they talked about the firmware, the chips. You can't do anything. You can't just replace a hard drive to rebuild. And I think it's important for all of you to know, because if any of you have rebuilt a machine more than once in a week, this is probably why. And you're not crazy. There's another vector that you didn't know about. Let's see. So then we had US NIST. I discovered that the NIST website, you'd go to, does anyone know what, well, I'll just explain what NIST is. NIST is the National Institute of Science and Technology. They publish hash sets online for people to download. Well, they had lectured about the importance of using SHA-1 signature algorithms for their websites and other things in government, and they weren't using SHA-1. In fact, they were using a deprecated cert, and it was named Boadicea, which is a reference to, I think, a Scotland queen that came and conquered the Romans. And it was a wildcard cert, and this was in early December. After I reported that, they revoked the cert shortly thereafter, and then the NIST website stopped using SSL. Well, what that means is if you don't see the nice little green bar, then anyone can impersonate a man-in-the-middle attack. Well, where do you think the whitelist for all the antivirus vendors come from that says, oh, we can ignore all these files? Anyone guess? It's those hash sets. So our online delivery method of allowing everyone getting their updates over the internet, but yet still today, if you go to many computer makers' websites, when you're trying to download the installation packages, it's on HTTP, not HTTPS, which makes it very susceptible to an injection or alteration of the package. So that's a real problem that's happening. The other thing I discovered is that the time.gov network time protocol servers also had compromises. So if you can control and forge the government's time server, you can take any device that's running NTP auto updates and roll the clock back. And then you can use expired deprecated certs that were breached to sign any package. Like if you want to hack the new iPhone, roll the time back, make your own package, sign it with one of these certs, and it will install. And that's how they got into the Bernardino phone. They pushed the time back and did that. Interesting on this whole front, I observed on a router, you know, after I started playing with the code, suddenly I felt, oh gee, I'm getting attacked a lot. Fortunately, I don't have much at my home other than my kids' video games and other stuff. So I went out, I bought a brand new router, I got a new laptop, I hooked it up at home. I unplugged the power on everything else in the house, and I had my laptop connected via Ethernet to the non-provisioned Linksys router, and I logged in with the default, you know, admin master password, whatever the default was. I rotated the password shortly thereafter. I went to the log setting, and I noticed another device had connected, and it said it was the, it said it was a, I think it was the NetShare, it was media server or something, and the MAC address on it, I believe, was 00050403021, which that's one that's used by the Kali hacking tools. So something had connected to my router, and so I unplugged it, I plugged it back in, and I went to the log settings, and then it had the time, and then it said that it rolled the time back on me, and then it said it's upgrading the firmware, and it took it forward 5, and then the time rolled back. And that's how I discovered the time rollback attack was happening. And I researched it with other researchers, and they said, yes, but what I did know is that there's a whole network out there that many people don't know. It's called, there's a document that was leaked in the CIA dump that talks about FluxWire. And it's a manual that, it's the network between light bulbs, between, it's a peer-to-peer network that's ad hoc and has everything talking to each other, your thermostat, your light bulbs, it relays. And in an event of emergency, that network could be used to, you know, allow people to communicate, but it's not really talked about much, but you could research it. Zigbee is one of the protocols. And so this network is used, these mesh networks are used to attack a target. So even if, you know, in my environment, I had my router wasn't even plugged into Comcast yet or provision, but somehow another device connected, it upgraded the firmware, but only after rolling the clock time back and then moving it forward. And I had just assumed, well, how could that be happening? I'm using, you know, time.gov and everything, and I'm researching the certs and everything. It seemed that the compromise went into the whole channel of how software is delivered. So we have a real problem in that, you know, if you're getting your updates, you need to know you're getting the right thing. And I wish we could go to the store and just buy a CD each month that it would have all the firmware, all the updates, so you don't have to worry about if you're compromised or you getting a bad feed. But that, I reported it to government. I was asked to come work for government, which I'm considering right now. But the solution that I saw was we need to secure a network time protocol. Number one, we've got to fix the cert. They fixed the cert in December. And then separate from the cert, making sure that we're using the proper encryption to sign drivers and even disallowing a simple solution like manufacturers turning off the ability to roll your clock date and time back prior to the month of manufacture would prevent all those compromised semantic certs, assigned certs, whatever, to be used to sign packages, because those are all in the trust. And, you know, the thinking has been, well, we want to have backward compatibility in case there's older software out there so people can run it. Well, by allowing those old deprecated certificates to vouch for software, those certs used weak algorithms that are crackable, they can be used to sign a package and trick any device into rolling forward. I'll have time for questions at that. So where this malware resides, so you've got the RAM, you've got NVRAM, you've got the little chips inside of USB devices, the SPI flash chips, option ROMs, network card potentially. There's a lot of place on board where things can be stored, and those represent potential attack vectors until they're secured by the makers. What I've noticed too is that you have non-IP but socket-level connections that can happen pre-boot. If you run a netstat and you're seeing all kinds of socket-level connections that aren't IPs going out, you might have a compromised system, and those connections might be traveling via sound, infrared, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, or Ethernet. And even if you have your button turned off and you think you're not running those, the firmware for the computer controls how your keyboard and your buttons work. So if that gets compromised, it can change how the computer works completely. So my wish would be to have a physical switch that severs. I've done testing where I've actually pulled out the Bluetooth and removed it and tested. I've tested with computers inside of RFID, Faraday cages, to see how they behave differently. And there are a lot of wireless ways computers communicate besides Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. The other thing that the malware will do is it will convert your partition, and you'll usually have like a long, we're applying updates, it's gonna take forever, because it's changing your drive, shifting the partition order. And so if you make note of your partitions, where they start, what sectors and whatnot beforehand, and you save that offline to print, later on, if you're concerned about it, you can go through and inspect to see that my partition tables alter, and are there partitions I can't get to. And one of the ways you can see into some of these hidden layers are through WMIC, the Windows Management Instrument command line. It will allow you to dump your physical drives and see some of the partitions. So how the malware infects, and I'm speaking generally here because I'm not talking about any one specific, but typically it's an attachment containing a payload. It can be sent to your cell phone. It can be put in email. It could be on the driver that loads when you connect to a network printing device is open in an attempt to get root control. So turning off SSH, before you bring a computer into an environment, having SSH turned off completely is an important thing, in my opinion, and making sure that you're not using default credentials. Another thing that happens is a target, like right now I'm on a network, if I got a pop-up saying, you got to install the latest update for Flash to be able to see this page, that's one of the attack vectors, and it tricks the user into installing it, and it's doing that by pushing something downstream. So if you get control of a router or ISP, you can push content at users, and unless they have the right settings for user control and prompt, they can basically force them or induce them to install the package. And then a lot of these attacks are relying on vulnerabilities of memory, memory buffer overflow attacks, side channel attacks, and so on. The cell phone networks are another point of compromise. I use Verizon. If I'm on the LTE network, I generally know that, I'm on the modern safe network, but if I detect my phone get pushed back to a 3G or 1X network, I know there's a problem, especially if I'm not traveling to a remote area. But what happens is those legacy networks don't have secure encryption technology. So if it can push you off to a deprecated network, it can then trick your phone into thinking the time's different and push an update at you and say, hey, there's an Apple update. So it can compromise a phone that way. And I think these vulnerabilities are now being worked on, but there was a period of time where there wasn't much a user could do. So what the software does is the malware establishes a backdoor for monitoring and exfiltration of data, your emails, even your encrypted communications. If you have a secure tunnel, it doesn't matter if someone's sitting behind my shoulder with a video recording of everything I'm doing. And that's what happens when you're above the operating system. It's like you've got a virtual machine that you're looking at. You can record it, you can do whatever you want with it, and that's what's happening. computers and phones, if you turn off your phone, I have a device that detects all levels of Wi-Fi signal. And when you turn off a phone, it will broadcast on GSM, 2G, 3G, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, and it beacons for about roughly 10 seconds. So you think your phone's off, but your phone's still sending all these signals out. And it's going to call out to say, hey, do you need me? Do you need to do something with my phone? And I believe this is, you know, how if we want to track someone and we're using this malware, it gives us a chance to send instructions to say, okay, turn on at this time, or to give it instructions when to boot and connect. So the other thing I noticed is it will run a fake clock time that makes your system show one time when the real time on board the computer is different, which allows it to keep, you know, keep the computer compromised. You can override the DNS. So even if you think your DNS in your operating system is one way, it won't be that way. And if you run tracer routes and you use the computer you're on that you're concerned about and you use a remote service, you can see what the differences in the routes are. And a lot of times you'll see just brownouts where there's asterisks and nothing before it connects. And that's another indicator. Let's see. So if you've got a firewall, you can see a lot of outbound traffic. Sometimes it's going out on TNS or other ports. And by just measuring, you know, what devices on your network are doing what, how much data is being transferred, you might find that a device is just constantly sending stuff out, and that might be an indicator that you have an issue. But once a device gets there, it can move laterally. The software has different modes of activation. Sometimes it's resident RAM only, which means unplugging the power and rebooting it will clear it. Other times it writes to the chips. And sometimes there are modes, according to the hacking team's manual, where it basically sits as a soldier waiting, if it's needed, to attack other clients, but not really doing anything with the machine. So there's different levels of activation. And then there's, it can be designed to automatically remove itself if it hasn't communicated with command and control within a certain amount of time, or they can remote self-destruct it. So you may find, you know, if you're evaluating a computer, if you use a hardware-based duplicator and you have lots of media, you can duplicate, put hardware write blocks on it and compare those drives, and you might see differences in file structure. You might see a lot of encrypted file containers that you can't get access to and so on that could help you detect it. The big thing that is important now is you know, most companies have bring your own device policies where they let people bring their smartphones in. And if you go into an FBI facility, they won't let anyone bring in computers or phone devices. And even the FBI director has the tape on board his camera. So that tells you what the state is. And you're not allowed to use any USB devices inside the government now. So all of us should be heeding that warning and knowing that there's something out there. So the detection, you know, most antivirus software programs won't detect it, because if you have control over the computer at a higher level, you can compromise the updates, you can whitelist the malware, there's a lot of other things that can happen. The hacking team's manual said that the one antivirus product that might detect it was Sophos. So I like to use Sophos. And I've seen in my testing it being able to detect telephony processes on Android devices that could compromise it. I bought a real cheap tabloid from Best Buy that was like $60, and I went to a network with no devices, I installed Sophos on it, and then I brought it in near a compromised computer, and it detected unknown telephony process, which I found interesting, because the tablet didn't even have, it only had Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. It didn't have a modem built into it, according to the marketing materials, but in fact, it did have a modem on board the chip. Not for my benefit, though. The other thing I mentioned before, hidden partitions, your firewall logs, tracer, running trace routes. The other thing that at least with the hacking team, you'd see certificates. Sometimes there's an HT certificate. There's others out there, but I think that it should be as easy as going to the library to get your tax bulletin to see what are the certs that are the good ones on a quarterly basis. Because if you were concerned and you could check your certs, that would be much easier. But if you're concerned about being compromised and you're trying to visit a website to see it, and you're not sure if what you're seeing is being manipulated, it raises that into question. So if you're concerned about a hack, verifying your search from multiple locations without your cell phone with you, but with different devices, different places, and printing that out is a good way to know. But I think that we have a lot more transparency on what should be in a trusted root cert. And I don't know why so many computers have lots of foreign rogue country certs built in to most devices. And you'll see, oftentimes you'll see search for Turkey, China, on many of these devices, but those are consumer-grade devices, but it would be helpful for there to be a safe list of certs that you can consult at a library that would update quarterly so you can make sure that you're running only what you need to. The other thing you'll see sometimes is you'll see a loopback connection on local hosts, because if you've ever run like a virtual machine, when you're in that environment, it's got to connect to the parent machine. So if you sever all your local host connections and the computer just stops, then you turn off all those extra devices, you might be compromised there. But my theory was I never wanted to have an IPv4 and an IPv6 address at once, because to me that's two connections. And I was used to always having one IP connection at a time and keeping others turned off, and I do that, but I noticed today a lot of computers want you to have multiple connections, and that's where potential for your backdoor comes in. So if you don't have those backdoor connections or secondary connections, that's a good thing, in my opinion. Let's see. There's a utility from Intel called ChipSec that will let you evaluate your UEFI tool, and checks to see, they claim that it will help you to detect if you have a CIA malware or other malware compromising your computer. So if you want to fix a compromised computer, replacing the hard drive isn't going to mitigate the infection if this happens to the device. Internet restore from iOS with a new hard drive won't, because again, the NVRAM and other chips on board will overlay and alter the OS that you get. I said previously, Apple security engineer Corey Kallenberg, who broke this stuff back in January of 2015, told me you had to replace your motherboard. And that was my thought, wow. It's on my project list to figure out how to take a beagle bone and make a chip flasher so I can flash the chips myself. I haven't gotten to that yet. I did paint my deck and porch, so, but it's on my list. One of the other things that, as I learned about the vulnerabilities, the more I thought about it, if you use the old the PS2 style mouse and keyboard, you don't have the chip in there, and all the computers were designed to recognize it without needing to have a special driver chip. So why do you need to have an SBI chip and a mouse or keyboard? Just use an older style PS2 mouse, and that lowers the risk that you're using a mouse that is remote broadcasting what you're doing, and it reduces your attack vector. You shouldn't share USB devices between untrusted computers. I broke that by using this mouse, but again, that's why I buy cheap computers and keep them patched. You want to make sure that you have your firmware on your devices, your printer, your things that you don't normally check. You want to make sure you're checking those, especially right now, to make sure they're up to date. How many people checked their BIOS firmware in the last couple months? Raise your hand. Okay, so we've got some security-minded folks here, but everyone really should be going to the websites, to Dell, to HP, or wherever your computer's from, and make sure that you're running recent firmware. Another thing, too, is as you download these packages, again, you know, my frustration is I go to Dell and it's like, why can't you give me a good certificate? They're more concerned about caching their drivers on various networks without using SSL, which means they can be injected. But you can still protect yourself by verifying the package, running the hash on it, and searching virus total to make sure that it's a known entity. Having your DNS, I recommend using OpenDNS, Cisco bought the company. It's much better than using Google DNS, in my opinion. And the software updates, you want to make sure that every patch Tuesday, you know, by that Wednesday or Thursday, if you want to make sure that your devices are patched. And with the package, this is the bottom of a keyboard I bought. It's probably on this one, too. We'll see. Yeah, on the bottom of all keyboards, it's got this warning that came on, you know, I checked with some IT people I knew, and we checked all the keyboards, and around 2005, they put the warning on saying, this device must accept interference received, including interference that may cause undesired operation. So someone insisted that there be some level of disclosure on what they were doing with this device, but I ripped apart a keyboard to try to figure out, you know, exactly how it worked, how it would be emitting. You know, some say that sounds are unique that could be discerned if your microphone's running, but I think that the more probable option is in the tip of the USB plug is that SPI chip. And if the SPI chip is compromised, it can act as a secondary device. It could be broadcasting and relaying what you type to another source. I was looking at government jobs on usajobs.gov, and there was one for the DEA, and I went through, it was for computer forensics, and on one of the questions was, are you familiar with harvesting data remotely from other monitors? And basically what they're saying is, this monitor is running, it's running at a certain frequency. That frequency can broadcast near range, and someone can be sitting out in the car seeing everything on screen. So that's what that's about, but a lot of people don't know that. So again, you want to be safe, you got to build your bubble with aluminum foil. And the other thing that people don't know is there's something called high fidelity network working. And that has to do with, you know how you get, does anyone have X1 where you can record in one room and see your shows in other rooms? Well, what it's doing is it's using your electrical outlets as a networking conduit. It's going through the cord. So all your home wiring, you know, effectively is turned into another network and antenna and can be used as a conduit. So again, you know, fire up FlexWire, you know, your whole house can be used as an antenna to potentially attack you. So here's an article I thought it was interesting on bad USB, and you know, what they did with Stutnex is they dropped a bunch of USB devices in the parking lot. I mean, all you had to do is drop a USB and put on their payroll records. Well, I'm gonna make a bet someone's gonna plug that in. And then boom, they load it up. When you plug in a device, if I plug in a device right now, if I plug in a mouse into a new port, it will pause and will say driver loading. If you go into the device manager for the driver, you should be able to look and see that you have signed drivers. If you don't see signed drivers, you might have a bad USB device. But that's how it happens, it's at the plug-in. And I've done this before, sometimes you'll plug in on a drive, you'll have the drive, but yet it's recognizing something. Well, why does it need to recognize a device if it already has your drive connected? That's the same with the mouse or keyboard. And that's that vector, the vulnerable vector that we have there.
Okay, so
here, I did a screenshot showing how to verify your download packets. So if you have an update and you want to check it, you can download, put the file in, run the scan it, and it will tell you when it was last analyzed. If you ever see that your package has never been scanned before, that's not good. Don't be the first to install software. I've seen that before with Google Chrome. It's like, I'm the first person trying to install this version of Chrome. You've got to issue on your network with packet injection. And it will show you how many AV vendors reported as a virus. So there's more in prevention. I'll put this up on Neubecker.com so you can see. I've got some tips on smartphones, what to do, what not to do. I talked about the attack points. And public policy, I think, from my perspective, once those vulnerabilities are leaked, there's a responsibility to get them patched, because it's good that our government has secrets to be able to collect intelligence, but once those secrets are out, we really need to move fast to secure them. And just a couple weeks ago, I saw on Shodan that the U.S. Senate was using non-supported Cisco routers that didn't have firmware patches available anymore. And then, come to think of it, all Cisco routers have a vulnerability that relates to all this stuff that was just recently patched. So there's a real problem and a need for people with skill sets, like many of you have, to help protect our country and keep things safe. I have some other thoughts on what needs to happen, but I want to just try to give a little time for questions before wrapping up. If you're looking for a speaker for our organization, I've got PowerPoint done. I finished it today. It's all fresh knowledge. I'd be happy to talk to you about presenting elsewhere. But a question back there?
Yes. Another vulnerability about NTP that nobody talks about is there's one guy that maintains it. His name is Harlan Stinn. And the last I checked, he only makes about $25,000 a year. It's a one-man show, in other words.
Any other questions? I think we're due for a break. Sorry, this is my first time presenting this particular presentation. If I went over a little, I apologize, but I'll be around, so feel free to talk to me afterwards. Thanks.
We're just gonna...
Go ahead. I can take questions.
No, it's not really a question.